This is Devin Kraft from the Science Faction Podcast. You're listening to the BS Podcast Network. Enjoy the show.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
Who are you?
My name is
Bond.
Bond. Batman.
Name's Bond.
James Bond.
I'm Batman.
Bond. James Bond.
I'm Batman.
Bond. I'm Batman.
This is the Batman vs. James Bond show. The show covering everything related to Batman and James Bond movies. And now, here's your host, Brian Thomas.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to an all-new episode of the Batman vs. James Bond show. The name's Thomas, Brian Thomas, and I am your host. And this is the show where we discuss everything related to Batman and James Bond movies. It's great to be back. I hope all of you have had a fantastic week. Mine was, you know, it wasn't just good. It was awesome. Spent some quality time with the wife and the pups. And I got to see a little movie this week, and what's it called? The Lego Batman movie, which we will be talking about later on in the show. And of course, lots of news has broken, as I'm sure that you're aware if you're a regular listener to the show. I've been tweeting and Facebooking and Instagram about it probably also. And if you check out movie news like myself, then you've been hearing about it. And of course, we will be talking about it tonight. But anyway, it is great to be back. Lots of things to get into, but before we jump into things, just a reminder, batmanversusbond.com. That's right, you know the name. It doesn't have a number, but it does have a website. It's batmanversusbond.com. Go there for all the latest shows and links, and definitely a fun little website. Nothing fancy, but it does have background about me, background to other podcasts and so forth, so definitely check that out. Speaking of which, you can also find my show on the BS Podcast Network. That's bspodcastnetwork.com. And speaking of which, the official swag of the Batman vs. James Bond show has arrived. T-shirts are now available. They are just $20.49. All you have to do is go to bspodcastnetwork.com, click on the shop tab. Proceeds benefit the Wayne Foundation's R&D department and the Q Branch Labs to avoid us getting hacked again. So let's get down to business. I already said it. Lots and lots of news to get to. I've said it before, what I love about this show is I never know, especially because we're at that time of the year, I'm thinking, okay, well, it's going to be a slow news week, and normally because it's February, and depending on where you live in the world, it's wintertime where I live. I live around the Washington, D.C. area on the East Coast, and it's been nothing but cold, dreary weather, and there isn't much to do because normally there isn't many movies that come out this time of the year, and there isn't, that are good ones anyway. Let me rephrase that. There aren't many big movies, especially when it comes to the Batman and James Bond universe, but things have changed, which is awesome, and a word I will be using a lot tonight, hopefully. And then when it comes to news, all we can do is say, okay, well, we might get a little, tidbit of news saying, hey, we have a picture from, being released for Justice League. We have, we might have a, an idea of Daniel Craig, who's the odds going to be put on this week? If Daniel Craig might be, playing James Bond, or is it going to be Tom Hardy, Tom Hiddleston, whatever. But in the case of this week, I would say this might be my most jam-packed news week ever. And I will go on record saying that right now, because when we last picked up, or where we last left off, and we were talking about the Batman movie and Ben Affleck, and just, I decided, let's do a recap of everything that's happened in these last 2 to 3 weeks, okay? So it all started, back when, with the Batman movie, it was, it was released that, or we were told that we would get a date of 2018, or actually the last date was supposed to be, filming would begin this year, that the script was all ready to go. Ben Affleck was going to be directing, writing, producing, and starring in the Batman. That's tentatively what it was called, is the Batman movie. Now, what we also heard is that, the script, Ben Affleck was saying, well, the script's not there, and if the script's not there, then I'm not going to be directing it. So, of course, we begin to scratch our heads, and we start to get a little antsy and a little nervous, saying, well, of course, he'll get it figured out. It's Ben Affleck, and he's going to, he makes, he's done movies like The Town, Argo, and, you know, we have plenty of faith in him. He's an Oscar-winning writer, and he is a, you know, he's an Academy Award winner for Best Picture before Argo. So it's in our favor. And he's working with Geoff Johns, who's known more in the comic books, or the comic world DC universe, for those of you that are more familiar with that. So everything's looking pretty cool, right? Well, then news broke that Ben Affleck was not going to be directing the Batman movie. That's right. He is not going to be directing the Batman movie. And I went so far as to record a special ghost episode out there. It is out there. I never like officially, you know, posted as I, you know, it's one of those like in between episodes. So if you do get a chance to listen to that, you know, that's cool. I would, I think you'd enjoy it because it's, you know, me unplugged with a Batman or just a rant of nothing about Ben Affleck directing Batman and so forth. But I have calmed down since then. Maybe, maybe not. But I will say that, you know, I've tried to be optimistic about this, saying, you know, okay, well, Ben Affleck is definitely not, you know, he's come out in the news. It's been confirmed by multiple credible sources saying he will not direct, but he is still going to write it. He is still going to produce it, and he is still going to be playing Batman Bruce Wayne. All right, well, maybe this might be for the better because, you know, it would be a lot, you know, and a lot of people have commented about this saying that's quite a big handful of a task for somebody to take on, not just as a director, but for an actor. And then you're writing it and you're producing it. Wow, that's, you know, you have to be really Superman. Oh, see what I did there. And, you know, obviously he's, you know, he's only human. So I will say that, you know, it might be for the best that he didn't do that. And it, you know, I think that I've also said on the show many times that I think his portrayal of Batman in Batman v Superman as Batman Bruce Wayne is, I think the more I watch it, the more I really enjoy his performance. I really think that if whatever date, whenever this does happen, that I think that we could get, you know, he could end up being the best Batman actor we've had ever. And I think that's, you know, I'm not obviously counting Val Kilmer in there. I'm not counting George Clooney, but I will say actors to the caliber of Michael Keaton, of Christian Bale. I think that's, you know, a pretty bold statement to say, and I don't think it's impossible. I think the guy's got a lot of talent. I truly do. Now, I will go on back to this news story about saying, okay, well, he's not writing it. And then a news story broke saying, guess what? The Batman solo movie, it was, you know, rewritten entirely by Chris Terrio. And Chris Terrio, I also broke the story last week saying that Chris Terrio is the one who wrote Argo for him, and he won an Academy Award for that, an Oscar. And in addition to that, he wrote Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice with David S. Goyer, who wrote the entire Dark Knight trilogy with Christopher Nolan. So, and we saw what we got with Batman v Superman, combination, and I've said this many times, of three different stories that could have been broken up into three different films, but it is what it is. Overall, it is a great film. It could have been better. But overall, knowing that Chris Terrio would be writing the Batman movie, and the fact that he has a history with Ben Affleck made me feel a whole lot better, because it feels like they have that kind of rapport. And if I would say, this is what I believe anyway, I have no proof of this, of course, that I would say that he was definitely the one that, you know, had more of an impact, or he definitely, you could tell that he possibly was the one that wrote the script, the section of the script where it was more centered around the Batman story, but around Ben Affleck's Batman. I would say you could definitely tell that was more him, just the caliber of the writing and so forth. I don't know how much of the actual story he had to write. I have no idea. Maybe he was brought in after the fact. I have no idea. I think it was tailored. It was initially written by David S. Goyer, and then they brought in Chris Terrio to kind of, like, you know, add some stuff to it. So I have no idea. But given that, then all of a sudden a story breaks that Ben Affleck, you know, the script that he turned in and Chris Terrio's script, it's getting a complete rewrite. It's going to be done all over again. It's going to be it's been thrown out, and, you know, now they're obviously, Warner Brothers has been on the lookout for a director, and now more recently we heard that script from Chris Terrio or even Ben Affleck was completely thrown out, and they're doing a complete rewrite of the Batman script. So no one has any idea what's going on with that. And here I'm thinking, wow, it must be pretty bad, you know, if you know, they have to throw away a script from Ben Affleck and Chris Terrio, because these are writers that, you know, are very well credited. But I'm like, okay, well, I'm listening to the movie news. And like I said, I'm definitely, you know, I've put it out there that I listen to, I read movie news every chance I get during my breaks at work. I listen to it on the way. I listen to it like a sports fan. I truly do. That's probably why I enjoy doing this, because I center around Batman and James Bond, the two things that I love. And, you know, hearing this, it's like, wow, what? I don't even know what to think. I truly have no idea what to think, because it's like in the middle of a rumor mill right now. It's like hearing, okay, well, you know, I can't even think of an analogy right now. It's like hearing that your favorite sports team, you know, it's that the head quarterback, you know, who's also the coach, he's being benched almost to that point. And you have no idea what the fate or the future of that player is going to be. That's the best, you know, analogy I could think of. And it's a really bad one, but I'm going to stick with it. So then we hear that coach, there you go. I try to do it this way. That a new director and the guy's name is Matt Reeves. And if you're not familiar with that name, that's okay. I had to look it up also. This is per Variety and for BatmanNews.com that this director, Matt Reeves, and he's known for directing Cloverfield, War of the Planet of the Apes. He's getting ready to do the final installment for War of the Planet of the Apes. And so he's familiar with doing blockbuster movies. So that makes me feel pretty good. And I liked War of the Planet of the Apes. I was kind of skeptical going into it. I'm like, I don't know if I really want to see this. And I came out of it, I'm like, this was really fun. This was a really good, you know, it was a good... And if you've listened to my reviews of movies or just how I feel about movies in general, especially when it comes to Batman and James Bond, that I like something that, you know, is character driven. I mean, and then you throw in your action and so forth in there. You center around the main characters, and that's exactly what he did with those films, or that film specifically. I never actually saw Cloverfield, true story, but that's okay. So Matt Reeves right now was in early talks to take over the directing duties for Ben Affleck. So what we also know right now is Affleck is still going to be, you know, having a significant role in the direction of the film. Obviously, he's still going to be, you know, starring as Batman. He's still going to be producing this movie. You know, we also know that right now Reeves is just finishing up post-production on War of the Planet of the Apes, and that comes out this July. And so they're saying, okay, well, if that's the case, if he's just finishing that up, then he should have no problem coming on to take on this project. So that is good news. I would say that is good news, okay? So let's look at it from this point of, you know, everything that I've just said up until this point. We have Ben Affleck, who bows out as the director. He's still going to rewrite it, or still write the script. They didn't like his script, so now they're throwing that out, and now there's the possibility that, you know, they might start from scratch and get a brand new script, and it could happen in at least 2019, but we got some good news out of that, saying that Matt Reeves, a director who's have some good films under his sleeve, could be taking over as the director of the Batman. So my thoughts on this are, like I said, it's good because I enjoy Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, and knowing that somebody could take that kind of a story, or I want to see his take on Batman. And I said before that I didn't want a big name taking over for the Batman. As a matter of fact, I went on record saying that I wanted an indie director. Now, I would classify Cloverfield as an indie independent movie, even though it was produced by J.J. Abrams, but it was on the smaller scale, but it still kind of had that, you know, I think it was a found footage movie, if I'm not mistaken. Like I said, I need to see that movie. But besides the point, though, I'm excited about that news because, okay, if that's the case, then, you know, maybe it's for the best. Maybe Matt Reeves talked with the studio, he's talked it over with Ben Affleck, and then those guys can all see eye to eye, and if they are throwing out the script, then maybe that script wasn't that good. Ben Affleck has had a lot on his plate. I'm not trying to defend him, but I will say that he had two movies coming out last year, which was The Accountant and one that he directed, Live by Night. Now, Live by Night obviously didn't do as well, but it is what it is, and maybe that had an impact on Warner Brothers and them deciding, okay, well, maybe we don't want him directing this a big tentpole movie like this because he just lost us about $75 million. That's an idea. Or there's other possibilities that Ben Affleck just saw the how much work went into Batman v Superman and how much work is going into Justice League on such a big blockbuster movie that, you know, maybe he doesn't want to take on this. Maybe he's kind of nervous about this. Those are things that I've heard in the news, and I could see both all good points. They really are. Honestly, I really don't give a damn. Honestly, I just want to see a good Batman movie. I want this movie to finally come together. I want Warner Brothers to get off their asses and say, this is the direction that we're going to be taking with our cinematic universe. And here goes my tangent, here goes my soapbox, because, yeah, I'm really getting tired, sick and tired, as a matter of fact, of every other, it's not even every other week now, it's almost every other day hearing problems with the DCEU, problems with a Batman film, Ben Affleck, you know, Ben Affleck's not writing, he's not going to be directing. And, you know, I also heard a story, and this is from Collider Movie Talk, and I'm a big fan of this guy. I truly am a big fan of this guy. Now, his name's John Campia. He is the host of Collider Movie Talk. He used to do something called the Movie Blog. And when you've heard, I'm sure, me say this before, that all film is subjective. He's the guy who says that. He's like, I would say, the godfather of movie talk, in a way. But he was saying that, you know, on the show a couple days ago, that he had heard from three separate sources involved with Warner Brothers over the last 4 days that Ben Affleck is looking to leave the role of Batman. John Campia stated that he had heard from three separate sources involved with Warner Brothers over the last 4 days that Affleck is looking to leave the role of Batman. He quoted saying, Ben Affleck, make no mistake, he wants out. He doesn't want to be Batman anymore. John Campia, like I said, he's well credited and he's very good at what he does. And like I said, I hold the highest respects for him. This is just a rumor, okay? This is nothing but a rumor, okay? So until something like this is confirmed, and he even went on record saying he's heard stuff before from other movies and from other credible sources, and then it didn't turn out to be correct. So like I said, I will continue to say that is just a rumor, just as he did. Now let's just look at this, saying, what if this is true? What if all this news that I just put out in just like about 5 minutes and just told you about, saying, okay, he's not going to direct it, he's not going to write it, and now he might not even want to be Batman anymore after the Batman. Well, then DCU is, you know, shoveling a pile of S, and they are doing it with the smallest, you know, shovel that they possibly can, because that would be such a big loss for the DCEU and Warner Brothers. It really would be, because I was just saying, Ben Affleck it could be one of the best Batman actors we've ever had, best Bruce Waynes we've ever had. He is a well-credited director. He's, you know, forget, I mean, yeah, he's had his share of not so well movies, but believe me, I've seen them, and I hear what you're saying. Hey, Pearl Harbor fans, well, it is what it is, but it's not that good of a movie. But, you know, he's paid his price, and then he resurrected himself by directing. And, you know, even so, I think that, you know, he can, you know, if given the right role and given the right material, that, yeah, I think when he brings it, he does bring it. Gone Girl, Batman v Superman, you know, and despite what the critics said about Batman v Superman, Ben Affleck's Batman was probably one of the better parts of that film. And, you know, if it just goes back to the DCEU and Warner Brothers, and it's, what is their plan? That's my question. What is their plan? Where do they plan on going with this? I mean, how many directors and how many, you know, actors are they, you know, they haven't really lost any actors, actually. If that was the case of losing Ben Affleck, the golden boy, I would call him, because I would say that, you know, just of his acting and his directing and so forth, losing such an A-lister because your studio couldn't handle, you know, one of the best DC, or one of the best comic book franchises ever, and you just totally blew it, and then everybody else loses respect. How many directors have they gone through right now? I'm thinking, before Patty Jenkins and Wonder Woman, there was another director. The Flash is now at a page one rewrite because they have lost two directors. Batman now has lost one director. I mean, it's a clear sign of something's up over there. It truly is. And I hope Matt Reeves, you know, can be confirmed by this time next week when I'm recording. I hope I can confirm that Matt Reeves is officially the director of the Batman, and then they can really get things moving. If they have to keep pushing back for, you know, to get the right movie, that's not a problem, because I'd rather them take their time, get the right script. And I won't even say a right script, because there is so many different scripts out there. There's so many different interpretations of Batman that could possibly be done. I don't care if it's, you know, if they want to do Batman versus the Joker, if they want to do Batman versus Deathstroke, if they want to do Batman escaping Arkham Asylum and having all the villains in there, great. Just give me a good story. Just give me something that's entertained. I'm sure that's difficult, you know, from a writer's perspective. from us as the fans, I would say it's easy for us to say, oh, well, all they have to do is just this, this, and this. We can be the nitpicky ones because we're, at the end of the day, we're the ones who criticize the films, whether we love them or we hate them. But I don't think, you know, to see it from a writer's perspective and from a director's perspective, it's obviously got to be, it's quite the challenge. So where I'm going with this is that if it ends up being 2019 or even 2020 when we get the next Batman film, and the way it's looking, it could be at least 2019. It's obviously not going to be 2018 because they would have had to start production by, I would say, within the next month, especially depending on how much how many reshoots they have to do with CGI and post-production and so forth. I don't think it would have been ready. And if it did, it would have been a rush job and probably would have been one of those movies like last year, just, you know, reshooting, recutting, and so forth, and it just would have been, it would have been okay, but probably not the Batman film that we deserved, right? So that's where I'm going with that. As news continues to break, mark my words, I will continue to talk about it on here. If you have something for me, if you hear a scoop, please let me know because, you know, at work, of course, my phone is pretty much off, but and I'm like closed off to the world, kind of like Bruce Wayne in the Lazarus Pit. But I find my way out, and then all of a sudden I hear all these news stories, and my mind is blown. So, you know, I will keep you afloat of what's going on. So, to pour a little bit more salt on a wound, there's, you know, Lawrence Fishburne came out this past week. He's in this movie called John Wick 2, which I still haven't had a chance to see because I picked another movie to see instead. But besides the point, Lawrence Fishburne is a part of the DCEU because he's been in two of the movies, Man of Steel and Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice. So in an interview with the LA Times, they caught up with him and, you know, he's been playing Perry White as the editor-in-chief at the Daily Planet. And he was explaining why he wasn't able to appear in the Justice League or why he won't be appearing in the Justice League. And he had this to say, quoted, "They asked me to come for a day, but I couldn't work it out schedule-wise. And really, why do you need the newspaper man in Justice League? You want to see The Flash. You want to see Aquaman. You want to see Wonder Woman. You want to see The Lantern. We've been waiting 35 years for these characters to show up on screen. What were they doing over there? Marvel has been kicking their ass. This is the comic book geek in me, who has a collection of comic books. I've been waiting to see these people on screen forever." This isn't the first time, end quote, by the way. This isn't the first time that an actor from, or actress from, a movie that was in Batman v Superman to say something about the DCEU, and I would say in a not so good way. We'll put it lightly, okay? We had Jeremy Irons last year saying, you know, something along the lines of that, you know, he was, you know, kind of disappointed in the movie. I forget exactly what it was, but he didn't have his, you know, he wasn't as positive about it. I guess he was more honest about it. And I think that Jeremy Irons did an excellent job is Alfred. I really do. I love his interaction. I love his little side quotes that he had. "And so falls the House of Wayne." Little things like that. That's the Ultimate Edition, but still. But then you have Lawrence Fishburne, which I think he is a tremendous actor. I've been watching him in roles since Miami Vice. That's how far back I've been watching him, all the way through The Matrix and, you know, the Mission Impossible movies. You know, I'm excited to see him in the new John Wick movie. And I think that, you know, and everything that he's done, I think he was one of the, you know, they said, you know, with Batman v Superman and the DCU that there wouldn't be any humor. Well, that was total crap because I would say the comic relief, if you want to call that, or the little, you know, the humor in the Batman v Superman was always from Lawrence Fishburne's character of Perry White. He was, you know, always, he had that kind of sarcastic, you know, those sarcastic comments in a way. He said, "Kent, where's Kent? What does he do? Click his heels a couple times and go back to Kansas?" And, you know, I really like that. Now, what I find this interesting is him saying, okay, DCEU is getting their ass kicked by Marvel. Well, what have I always said? It's not a competition. But guess what? It always comes down to that way in the eyes of a fanboy. And clearly, Lawrence Fishburne is a fanboy. And yeah, you know, if we're really going into this, which I hate going into, but yeah, the DCEU, if you're looking at it from the beginning of the DCEU, which started only in 2013, and the Marvel Cinematic Universe started back all the way in 2008. Now, I'm always going to use this as an argument saying that, okay, well, Marvel's been doing this since 2008. the DCU has only been doing this for, it's going on its fourth year now. It's only had a total of three movies. So, you know, if you want to compare apples and oranges, sure, but they're different types of movies. They really are. When it comes to a Marvel Cinematic Universe, this is not meant as a jab at it, but I will say that Marvel movies are more lighthearted. They are sometimes more fun, and they're movies. When it comes to the DCEU, they're more character driven, and they are more on the quality of a film. And I always say there's a difference between movies and films. And James Bond movie fans know exactly what I mean with that. Batman movie fans know what I mean with that. If you're talking, you know, Batman movies, I will say that, okay, that Batman Forever, and especially Batman and Robin, is, you know, it's a comedy also, but it is a movie. When you talk about the Nolan trilogy, those are films. Even talking about Batman v Superman, I count that as a film because it's pretty deep. It really is, looking at everything that's going on there. It's a drama. When you're looking at the Marvel Cinematic Universe, those are more like, okay, yeah, they are centered around their main characters, but at the end of the day, it's, okay, well, we're going to have some shawarma, and, you know, we save the world and so forth, and, you know, happy day. And, maybe you can make an argument about Captain America Civil War. Sure, I could see that. Not everybody had a happy ending, but still, I will say that there's a difference between night and day. See what I did there. But I have nothing, I will not, you know, criticize the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and I will not criticize the DCU. I think they're totally different in a way, and I will say that given the first three movies that we've had of the DCU, I will say that it's been good, but it could have been better. And I will leave that with Suicide Squad. When the Marvel Cinematic Universe, they've had, I can't even keep track of how many movies they've had. They've had over 10 to 12 movies or so. So they've had a chance, and things are run differently over there. And, you know, it is what it is. And I will say that if DCU still feels it has to play catch up, then they really have to rethink their strategy. They truly do. Do what you guys do best. Make one movie at a time and then go from there. And I'll leave it at that. So given that, Justice League has also got a new synopsis. There was no way to transition to that, but I just did. So we have a new synopsis plot via Cosmic Book News, and it goes like this. In the wake of Clark Kent's Superman's death at the hands of Doomsday in Batman v Superman, vigilante Bruce Wayne Batman reevaluates his extreme methods and begins reaching out to extraordinary heroes to assemble a team of crime fighters to defend Earth from all kinds of threats. Together with Diana Prince, Wonder Woman, Batman seeks the cybernetically enhanced former college football star Vic Stone, Cyborg, speedster Barry Allen, The Flash, and Atlantean warrior king Arthur Curry, Aquaman. They face off against Steppenwolf, the herald and second-in-command and alien warlord Darkseid, who is charged by Darkseid with hunting down three artifacts hidden on Earth. So, I won't go too much more into the Justice League, but I will just say that it sounds like a pretty cool plot. I'm excited about Justice League despite everything that's been coming out. I think that, I'm ready for a trailer. I truly am ready for a trailer. So let's transition here into something that I didn't expect to get, but we have some James Bond news this week, and I'm actually talking James Bond 25 news this week. That's right. So this past week, it was reported from multiple sources, more of the UK news, that the Eon production bosses have all the plot details lined up, and they've secured a helicopter that will be blown up as a part of a huge stunt. Producers are thought to have finished up with the script and have already purchased the chopper from Aeronautical Museum and the Werner Drode in the German state of Saxony-Anhalt. Anyway, they bought a model, a Bell UH-1D or Huey, which was introduced in 1959 worldwide, including in the U.S. Air Force and Vietnam War. The museum's director, Clemens Ollick, explained the helicopter bought by Eon is functional, but its engine needs to be changed. He'll be transferred to London Heathrow before the shoot in a few weeks. So this helicopter, I'm trying to, obviously it would help if I had a picture to show you guys, but this is a podcast, but I will paint this picture in your head. We've actually seen this helicopter in a Bond movie before. Now, it's been all the way back in 1995 in GoldenEye, and you have to think back to this. It's the very end of GoldenEye when, after James Bond and Natalia, they escape the satellite after, you know, defeating, you know, Alex Trevelyan. Spoiler alert there. And, you know, they, Jack Wade sneaks up on him, you know, saying, "Yo, Jimbo," and, you know, "I promised I'd be here." And then he says, "Yo, Marines," and the Marines show up and the helicopters fly in. That's a Bell helicopter. As a matter of fact, there were two Bell helicopters in there. I can't think of any other time a Bell helicopter was used in a Bond movie. If you know, then please let me know. But it's, I always like this about Bond movies, especially, and I think they've done something similar with this in Quantum of Solace, where they went at the plane chase in there. They had like this really, really old, you know, kind of a classic, I would say it's like a cargo plane in a way. And Bond and Camille, they're, you know, going, flying over in Bolivia, and they're looking at sinkholes and trying to find out what Green is after, and they're flying this whole plane, but they found a way to, like, you know, kind of throw in that classic aspect, and they had a plane chase with it. So if that's what they're going to do, something similar with the helicopter, with this helicopter, I have no idea. They of course have to get the helicopter flying, though, don't they, as they as the museum guy said. So this is really exciting for me. And there's even more good news, and we're going to take this as a possibility anyway, that it is having to do with James Bond, okay? So the director of watches from Omega, his name's Reynald Ashleman, sorry to pronounce that incorrectly. Omega's been a partner with the James Bond series since actually GoldenEye in 1995. They announced that they're going to meet with Daniel Craig in 1 to 3 weeks in order to ask him which model, a new Seamaster possibly, he intends to wear in the new adventure of 007. Oh, let me just say that the Omega watches are there. I love the Omega watches. Now, don't get me wrong, a Rolex that, you know, like the Rolex that Connery used to wear back, especially the most iconic one is when he's checking the time in Goldfinger. He lights the cigarette, looks at the watch, and then, you know, of course, the explosives blow up and he blows up the drug factory. But, you know, when it comes to the Omega, I love always trying to figure out what's the next Omega that, you know, Bond is going to be wearing. And this is where the Bond geek in me nerds out. And I know a lot of you out there, you know, that we always pay attention to the clothing, the attire that Bond is wearing, the accessories. In this case, it's the watch. You know, I'm really excited about this, because does this mean that Daniel Craig is coming back? I'm holding out hope that, you know, if he does return, do one more, and, you know, oh man, I don't even know what I want with this one. I've said it before what I want, but I'm nervous about this, because all the pieces might be falling into place. Now, what I find really funny about this is that the week that everything is, I'll put this very carefully, but everything is falling out of place in the Batman DCEU. Things are slowly starting to ramp up in the James Bond universe, and I'm like, wow, that's pretty ironic, isn't it? Because here we are in 2016 thinking we didn't get one bit of Bond news aside from Daniel Craig saying, if I ever left the role, I'd really miss it. And that was about the extent of it. And, you know, the possibility of other actors taking place, like Tom Hiddleston or Tom Hardy. And now we hear that, you know, not only are they picking up a stunt helicopter, but they also are meeting to talk about the watch that he could be wearing in the next Bond movie. Guys, I talked to somebody online about this, and you know, we were saying about, what do you think the chances of getting a Batman movie before, or the James Bond movie before the Batman movie? And honestly, right now, if I had to be a betting man, we're going to get the James Bond movie before we get the Batman movie. If they have a script in place, and who knows who's going to be writing this, because we know that after I broke this last week, that Neil Purvis and Robert Wade, they have no involvement with this, and they've been writing since The World Is Not Enough. Is the writer going to be Jonathan Logan, the writer of Gladiator, Skyfall, and Spectre? Who knows? Who knows what, you know, could happen out of this? I'm getting really anxious about this, but mark my words, we're going to see a James Bond movie in the next couple years before we see that Batman movie even get, you know, into production. There we go. Another little bit of James Bond news that I did want to share, and this is just, you know, a director just saying, hey, you know, I'm a fan of the franchise, and I would love to direct a James Bond movie and take it into a different direction. The director of John Wick 2, his name is Chad Stahelski, and, you know, he was, like I said, he's directed John Wick and John Wick Chapter 2, and, you know, he was saying that there's obviously some, you know, parallels between the John Wick franchise and the James Bond franchise, and, he was asked, you know, which, you know, kind of project he would like to be interested in directing next. And he says that the James Bond movie he'd be very interested in. Quoted saying, "I'm interested in projects where you can world create. To jump back into somebody else's world where it's already been around for so long would be scary. But if there was one property that wouldn't be a bad one to try and invest yourself, especially because of the ebb and the flow of the Bond universe right now, I think the timing is good for a slight reinvention with a different perspective shift. Bond has gone from completely serious to totally cheeky to really fun again to emotional to serious to internal to external. I would love to give the pitch if they got my wacky version of it. And it fit, yeah. That's almost a dream too big." So I said before that, you know, I would love this guy to direct a Batman movie. To see him in the James Bond universe directing, I don't know. I mean, if you've ever seen a John Wick movie, you know that it's a pretty far out there action film. It's got the gung fu in there, and you know, the action in there is incredible. It really is. The story is, you know, it's a pretty simple story, but you know, maybe one day this guy, you know, can have his take on there. I mean, I'm always open to a different interpretation on a Bond movie, because after this, I said that maybe it's time that they go back to something more along what the Sean Connery days were of, you know, more of like, let's steal some nukes, let's do some world domination, that kind of a take, instead of just such a personal story. You can have both. I'd be open for that. I really would. But I don't know if his directing style would fit. I can only compare it to when I heard that Quentin Tarantino wanted to direct a Bond film, and Quentin Tarantino, if you know the name, then you know what his style of movie making is, and it's pretty out there. I'm not saying that, you know, Stiliski's is quite like that, but it, you know, I don't know. I don't know if I would be ready to see him direct a James Bond movie, but I wouldn't rule it out. I really wouldn't, but I'd like to see him more go direct a Batman movie, but it doesn't look like we're going to get either of those. So let's move in, and I had to cut this short, unfortunately, because I was going to spend the whole episode on this, as a matter of fact, but now let's talk about what I had a chance to see last week. So I teased at the beginning of the show, Everything is Awesome, and boy was it when I saw this movie. This movie was awesome. I am talking about the Lego Batman movie. Boy, was this fun. Let me start off real quick. And like I said, this is going to have to be a really shortened review. I'm really sorry. Maybe another time I can come back and revisit this, but duty calls and so does the news. But the cast was Will Arnett as Bruce Wayne Batman, Zach Galifianakis as voicing the Joker, Michael Cera as voicing Robin, Rosario Dawson as voicing Barbara Gordon Batgirl, and Ralph Fiennes, yes, from the James Bond world, as Alfred Pennyworth. The synopsis reads like this: "There are big changes brewing in Gotham, but if Batman wants to save the city of the Joker's hostile takeover, he may have to drop the long vigilante thing, try to work with others, and maybe, just maybe, learn to lighten up. Maybe his superhero sidekick Robin and loyal butler Alfred can show him a thing or two." So let me go right into my highlights for this movie, because I tried to get my wife to go to see this movie, but she chose the gym, and shame on her for saying that. You know, I was even debating about going to see John Wick Chapter 2 over this, but, you know, the Batman fan of me said, hey, you know what? This is a Batman movie, and if it's, you know, it wasn't just about the ratings, because it got a 90% on Rotten Tomatoes, all positive reviews, and I'm like, I really want to see this, because the little kid in me always comes out, especially when it comes to, you know, Batman movies and the James Bond movies, but more specifically because I loved Legos. I grew up with Legos growing up, and, you know, kids these days, and I sound like an old man when I say this, but kids these days don't know how good they have it because they have all these different kinds of Legos, and I'm actually holding one of them in my hand, and it is little Lego Batman. And, you know, I got a whole bunch of them for Christmas, but besides the point, back on track here, when I saw the previews when I heard that they were going to make a Lego Batman movie, I'm like, well, it's probably going to be a kids movie and so forth. And then there's nothing wrong with a kids movie, but it's going to be one of those, you know, but it might have, you know, it's Lego Batman, and it could be interesting. I might see it, but I'm not going to go out of my way to see this. After seeing the trailers all last year, everything leading up to this, I'm like, I'm sold on this movie. This movie looks like a lot of fun. It looks like it has humor for everybody, and that it was everything that I hoped it could be. It really was. It was hilarious. There was jokes for, you know, for adults. There were jokes for kids in there, and, you know, there were so many Easter eggs in this movie. And that's what I was, I had heard. I'm like, okay, well, I was thinking, okay, well, maybe you'll get, you know, I knew that there was going to be the Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice one in there, because we saw that in the trailer saying, no, the Joker isn't my greatest enemy. Superman's my greatest enemy. I like to, you know, I don't like to have enemies all the time. You know, I like to, you know, float around, that kind of deal. And, you know, so I was like, okay, so they're making fun of Batman v Superman. Already on board with that, because it is an easy jab. It really is. But boy, I don't want to spoil this at all, but I will say that I think they had an Easter egg for every single Batman movie going all the way back to the original Batman, the movie with Adam West. Yes, they had, you know, they made fun of Batman v Superman, but there were also things they talked about the Dark Knight trilogy. They had a line in there from Burton's Batman. They had, you know, things from the Batman animated series, specifically, if you're a fan of Batman Beyond, there is something for you in there also. And what's great about this is you really have to pay attention to this because it happens so quick. They don't just clearly just go out of the way on certain things saying, oh, well, we're just going to throw this in there. How they did it, and, you know, the detail that they went into this, they had all the Batmobiles in there, and I'm like, the Batmobile, oh my god. And it's like when Robin goes, finds his way into the Batcave, and I'm like, oh my god, I feel like I'm in the Batcave, because they have all these things in there that I could ever want, that I would want to see. And it's Legos, for crying out loud. You know, the voice performances, let's talk about that. The voice performances by Will Arnett, you know, I mean, obviously everybody says that Kevin Conroy is the voice of Batman. And yes, he is, because if you're a fan of the animated series and, you know, Batman the Killing Joke and most of the animated movies, he's done the voices for that. I will say Will Arnett did an excellent, amazing job with this. He really, you know, he definitely had that, you know, what we envision of Batman, at least my vision of Batman, is that somebody who takes himself so seriously. But, you know, Will Arnett was still, you know, he had the jokes in there, you know, there was music in there and so forth, the action, the stunts and so forth, his little one-liners in there. Zach Galifianakis as the Joker, I really liked his spin on there. He didn't try to be like Heath Ledger, he didn't try to be like Jack Nicholson in there, you know, none of that. He really had his own spin in there. Ralph Fiennes as Alfred, I was like, wow. I mean, obviously I knew he was going to voice it, and like I said, I know him more as M now from James Bond, and you know, he did fit the personality of Alfred, and I think that, you know, you can only do so much as a voice actor, and to portray somebody on character who's animated, that's got to be difficult, but their voices really, really work for this. When it comes to the story, I kind of knew what to expect. Like I said, it's pretty much Batman, you know, what happens when Batman, after he saves the world, after he defeats the Joker, he defeats all the bad guys, what does he do in his spare time? Well, those are all good questions, and people have always asked me that too. You know, people that know that I'm a Batman fan, they're like, well, what would Batman do? Would Batman do this? Well, in the case of the movie, like, and I'm only going to talk about what was in the trailers, because that's what, you know, if you haven't seen the movie, then I don't want to spoil anything for you. But Batman goes home, and he's just by himself. Yeah, Alfred's there, but, you know, what happens when Alfred's not there? Well, he's going to watch a movie by himself. He's going to swim with the dolphins by himself. He's going to eat his lobster by himself. And, you know, it's really interesting. And then they have times where they, you know, they do go back, and luckily they didn't show this again, but the death, they do talk about the death of his parents and the impact, and about him shutting people out and not letting people close again. And for an animated movie, and I count the Lego movies an animated movie, that's pretty deep. And there were some things that really hit me with this. There really were, saying, okay, well, you're this loner, and you're afraid of, you know, letting somebody back in. You're afraid of, you know, them getting hurt again. And you know, what are you going to do about this? And I really, really got to say that this movie is a 5 out of 5. It really is a 5 out of 5. I love this movie. I almost want to go see it again the more I talk about it. And I, you know, I tried to find every way to get my wife to go see this movie with me. I ended up going seeing it by myself, and I still, you know, of course, enjoy seeing movies by myself from time to time. But this is a movie that, you know, if you can get your friends, your family together, because there's a very, This movie definitely has something. Has some really big or very good messages in here when it comes to family, and I don't think that's something we've ever really gotten in a Batman movie before. Maybe you can say it was attempted before, but not like this. It really wasn't. This Batman movie, sure, Batman movies have had a message before, but not like this. I will say that, you know, it's good for all ages. You know, I know a lot of people say that, but it really is fun for all ages. You know, there's something in there for everybody. The jokes, the music, the story. You know, it's about just under, maybe about an hour and a half or so. So, and it goes by pretty quick. And like I said, if you're a Batman fan, you are really going to love this and you're going to appreciate this because it does make fun. I don't want to say it makes fun, but in a way it does. It does, you know, it knows what parts to make fun of at other Batman movies. And I really admire that about that. So it didn't just, you know, just say, oh, well, this Batman movie, yada, yada, yada. It didn't do that. It just kind of, they were very smart about how they did their Easter eggs in there and so forth. But I will leave it at that. But yes, definitely check out the Lego Batman movie. So like I said, when the movie comes out, maybe on Blu-ray or HD, I will do a full review of this. But I'm sorry, we have to move on here. So let's talk some birthdays and anniversaries. Yes, lots of birthdays this week. Starting off with Maude Adams. That's right. Maude Adams celebrates a birthday on February 12th. She played Andrea in The Man with the Golden Gun and Octopussy in Octopussy. Yeah, I really, really liked Maude Adams. I think that, I mean, obviously, I liked her more in Octopussy because she was only like the secondary Bond girl. And if you're a Bond movie fan, you understand what I'm talking about with that. But for the Batman fans, normally what happens with Bond girls is there's two tiers. There's the top tier Bond girl, which, you know, usually, you know, James Bond, you know, runs away with at the very end. And the second tier usually gets killed. And in the case of, you know, The Man with the Golden Gun, I won't spoil that for those of you that haven't seen that, but I will just say that she was a second tier Bond girl, and you'll understand what I mean. When it comes to the James Bond universe, not that I know of this happening again, for an actress to come back and be the main Bond girl and, you know, with the same actor that she was already in a movie with. In this case, it was Roger Moore. So she was with Roger Moore twice in two different Bond movies, which was pretty cool. And, you know, I think that the role that she played with Octopussy, how, you know, she was trying to say to James Bond, hey, we're two of a kind, and, you know, you should, you know, leave the Secret Service, you should be with me, and we can kind of conquer the world, that kind of a deal. And, I mean, she was a smuggler and so forth, and she wasn't really a villain, per se, but I think that the chemistry that her and Roger Moore had was probably one of the better chemistries that we've seen, at least in the Roger Moore era. So, happy birthday, Maude Adams. Joe Don Baker, yes, he also celebrated a birthday on February 12th. He played Brad Whitaker in The Living Daylights and Jack Wade in GoldenEye and Tomorrow Never Dies. Now, I've always said that GoldenEye was my first Bond movie that I ever saw, so to me, Joe Don Baker will always be Jack Wade. Yo, Jimbo! And, hey, Bond, you do any gardening? And, you know, those little lines, and obviously, I'm a bigger fan of him as the Jack Wade character. Going back in watching him in The Living Daylights, I think he seemed kind of out of place as a villain, especially for the Timothy Dalton era. I think that it didn't work as well. I mean, I still look at him, I'm like, okay, well, he's more evil Jack Wade, but, and, you know, he kind of had that humor element to him also. He's like, you've had your six, now I have my 26, that kind of whole spiel, whatever it was. And, you know, I kind of like that, but I still think that I think the role of Jack Wade was a better fit for him. I wish we could have seen him more in the Brosnan era. We saw him a little bit in Tomorrow Never Dies, and I like the final quote that he actually had was, he didn't even say goodbye. And that was like the end of Jack Wade. And I really wish we would have gotten him in Die Another Day. I don't think he would have fit in The World's Not Enough, but still, I really liked him. He was definitely one of the better Bond allies that we've had. Moving on here, Louise Maxwell celebrates a birthday. She played Miss Moneypenny in all the Sean Connery era, almost all of, actually, no, she did play it in all of the Roger Moore era and George Lazenby's only Bond movie. Yes, she played Miss Moneypenny. Whenever you say Miss Moneypenny, I immediately think, just like everybody else, Louise Maxwell, because, well, not because she was the first one to portray that character, because something about her charm that she had in there, the, you know, especially with Sean Connery, how she was very, very flirty and, you know, saying, oh, you never dressed like that to take me to dinner, that help kind of spiel. And, you know, I'll bake you an angel cake. You can get me a ring with a diamond in it. Would you settle for flowers? Yes. And I really like that. I liked and how she fit it more for George Lazenby with James Bond, where George Lazenby threw the hat at his wedding to her. She was really sad. And I was like, oh, poor Miss Moneypenny. I really want her to have somebody. I really want maybe her. I really wish in a way she would end up with James Bond. And, you know, with all due respect to the actresses, you know, who have portrayed the role of Miss Moneypenny since then, I still believe that Louise Maxwell is the definitive Moneypenny. So happy birthday, ma'am. The next birthday here is Jane Seymour. She celebrates her birthday on February 15th. She played Solitaire in Live and Let Die and is actually her first role as an actress. Yeah, I was recently watching her in Live and Let Die. It happened to be on a couple weeks ago. And gorgeous, gorgeous woman. She really is. As a Bond girl, and I really liked what she did with that. She, you know, I liked how her and Bond meet for the first time. And how Bond plays the trick on her with all the cards, you know, the card that he bought the roll or he bought the deck of cards and then he just snuck them into her pile that said the lovers and played a trick on her to get him to sleep with him. Very, very sneaky, Mr. Bond. Very sneaky indeed. But still, I really like that. And, you know, I like she was a typical damsel in distress and Bond had to save her and so forth. But, you know, sometimes I like that kind of role and Jane Seymour definitely played that very well. Cesar Romero celebrates a birthday on February 15th. He played the Joker in Batman 1966 and the Batman TV show. I still plan, and I know I've teased this before, but I will be doing some kind of review sometime this year on the original Batman movie with Adam West and Cesar Romero. So happy birthday, sir. Denise Richards celebrates a birthday on February 17th. She played Christmas Jones in The World Is Not Enough. Also recently watched that. And Denise Richards, gorgeous woman indeed. Best Bond girl? Probably not. No. I won't say she's my least favorite Bond girl. Definitely not. But I will say that her as a nuclear physicist and defusing a nuclear bomb, I don't know if I buy that so well. I do always get a kick out of the Christmas jokes in there. And, you know, when she meets Pierce Brosnan in there, 007, and she's like, Jones, Christmas Jones, and don't send any Christmas jokes. I've heard them all. He's like, I don't know any doctor jokes. And, you know, how they do their little thing at the end saying, I always thought Christmas only comes once a year. And I'm like, Wow. You go, Pierce Brosnan. And besides the point, though, Rory Kinnear celebrates a birthday on February 17th. He played Bill Tanner in Quantum of Solace, Skyfall, and most recently Spectre. Yeah, the character of Tanner is one that's always kind of secretly been around. If you're a Bond fan, you know that he's been around since, oh my goodness, I always remember him first being on screen when For Your Eyes Only, and he was filling in for M, not the character. I'm talking about the character of Bill Tanner. And then when it came for the Pierce Brosnan era, they brought in Bill Tanner, and he was more involved with, you know, helping 007 on his missions, giving him his briefing and so forth. This new Bill Tanner that Rory Kinnear has created, I would say created, or that he's starred as, he's way more involved than that. He's always with M, and he's not just giving he doesn't give 007 his briefings, but he's in the field. He's almost like Bond's friend in a way. And I really like that. And I really like Rory Kinnear. I've seen him in a couple other movies before, and I think he's a very talented actor. So I hope we get to see him one more time on screen with Daniel Craig's James Bond 007. So it is now time for this week's Versus. That's right. Versus is the part of the show where we take movies from the Batman and or James Bond franchises versus other movies in the same wheelhouse are completely different. Last week's Versus was an interesting one. It was all based on, you know, it focused on Oscar-nominated production design in the case of Batman 1989 versus The Spy Who Loved Me because it was Ken Adams' birthday. Now, Batman 89 was a winner when it came to production design, and it was the winner when it came to production, or when it came to the votes. The public has spoken, the crowd has spoken on the Twitter universe. Everybody picked Batman 89 over The Spy Who Loved Me. It ended up being 75% over to 25% by The Spy Who Loved Me. I will still say and make the argument that Ken Adams is a production designer. I still think he deserved it for The Spy Who Loved Me. I also think he deserved it for Moonraker in that aspect also. But both well-credited production designers, and especially in the idea of Gotham City and its production design, I really liked how they did in the Burton films. So this week's versus is Skyfall versus Inception. Now, why did I pick those two movies? Well, we're still carrying on with the Academy Award Oscar theme here, because the Oscars come out on February 26th. And of course, you know, the movies that I would like, you know, we would want nominated, like a Batman movie, or we can't nominate a James Bond because it doesn't fall in that, but still, we can have fun with this. So, a little interesting fun fact here. In 2010, Wally Pfister, he was nominated and won for Best Cinematography for Inception, directed by Christopher Nolan. He has also been nominated for Batman Begins. He was the cinematographer for The Dark Knight, or actually the entire Dark Knight trilogy. And then, when it comes to the case of Skyfall, in 2012, Roger Deakins was nominated for Best Cinematography for his work on Skyfall, but lost to the cinematographer for Best Cinematography for Life of Pi. Now, I know which one I like better, and I've actually gone on the show before and said why I picked this movie, but I want you, once the Twitter poll goes up, by the time you hear this show, definitely cast your vote. Remind, you know, and it's not just a question of which movie is better. I want you to focus when, if you have to go back and watch these movies, and I think I will, just because I want to, as long as I have the wife's approval to take over the TV with for a couple hours. I will say that, you know, both these movies focus on the cinematography. Something about cinematography, especially lately as I get older, like I said, it's something I really much pay attention to in a movie, because when you film a movie, and for any film fan out there or film nerd out there, you know that it's not just about, you know, what you show on screen. It's just how it's captured, the camera angles and so forth. And I think both these movies do such an incredible job of it. So definitely cast your vote for this week's versus. And now on to the final part of the show. It's time for the trivia question of the week. Now, the segment of the show debuted last week, and I said to make this segment more exciting, I was going to make it a contest. And this is one for you, the listeners, to participate in, and all you had to do was submit your answers to batmanvjamesbond@gmail.com. And let me go back to the question first. This actress was in a Bond movie and was also in a movie with an actor that is currently playing Batman Bruce Wayne, where she was nominated for an Academy Award for Best Actress. The answer was Rosamund Pike, who was a Bond girl in Die Another Day with Pierce Brosnan, but she was also in a movie called Gone Girl, where she was nominated for Best Actress for an Academy Award when she played alongside Ben Affleck in that. And the winner of last week's trivia question of the week is Mr. Michael Dyke. So congratulations, Michael. I will get in touch with you if I haven't already. And make note, I will be running another trivia contest next week, so stay tuned for that. But you have to, you know, get your answers in there so you have a chance to win in this contest. All you have to do is send your email to batmanvjamesbond@gmail.com. So that wraps it up for this episode of the Batman vs. James Bond show. Please subscribe on iTunes and Spreaker and rate it 5 stars and leave a nice little review for me on there. I would very much appreciate it. The biggest thing I ask for you is to always share this show with your friends. Once the show goes up on social media, share it, retweet it, like it, do whatever you got to do. That's a big help for me. Follow me on the various social media networks, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Batman vs. Bond. Find the show on batmanvsbond.com and on the BS Podcast Network. And be sure to check out all the other great programming on there, including Science Faction Podcast, Geek Dig Podcast, and Horribly Awkward Podcast. Like James Bond, I will return. Until next time, I'm Brian Thomas. Thanks for listening, and have a great week, everyone. Bye-bye.
The preceding podcast is part of the BS Podcast Network. Visit bspodcastnetwork.com for more shows just like this one, and perhaps a few that are just a little bit better.